Hi everyone, my name is Jonathan, or the English pronunciation would be Jonathan. I have a degree in psychology and I like to do YouTube videos in my free time about stuff that I find personally interesting and that I think is worth sharing. I have a video series about the person-centered approach, as you might know or not, and this is the fourth video I think in this series. Just a short disclaimer, I am not a therapist, even though I have a degree in psychology. I am not a practicing clinician, I'm just someone who is interested in the field, so what I'm going to say is not based on experience or anything, and maybe I would say some things differently if I had more experience. I have only some experience through internships, so keep that in mind. Nevertheless, I do have interesting things to say, because the stuff is just interesting per se. Now before starting, I know that this is going to be a long video, so I don't know if you want to watch the whole video. In the description, I will have an overview of all the different sections of this video. So maybe you want to watch a specific section. So please use the description, because there will also be the timestamps of every single section of this video, and you can jump to that section if you want to watch a particular section. I will start with a brief summary of what the person-centered approach is all about. The idea is that you heal by providing a certain therapeutic climate, by creating a certain atmosphere that is facilitative for personal growth. So as a therapist, you don't apply a certain method, but you approach the situation with certain attitudes that help to create this climate. And there are three major attitudes or core conditions. First, the therapist strives to be congruent, and that means that he is real or genuine in the relationship, that he verbalizes what he feels, and that he hides nothing from the client. At least nothing that is relevant for the relationship or for therapy. Then the second core condition is unconditional positive regard, and that is the attitude that you accept your client's experience unconditionally, basically. And that means that the client may experience any feeling that he or she has at the moment and will not be judged for it. Unconditional positive regard also contains a positive, warm attitude towards the client. And Rogers called it prizing the client. Well, in this video, we are going to talk about the third core condition, which is empathic understanding. So, my intent with this video is to present the Rogerian view of empathic understanding. I do not mean to imply that the view of Carl Rogers is perfect. Of course, there are gaps and there are things you could criticize, but I also think that he gets a lot of things right. And I think it's a good starting point if you want to think about the question, what does it mean to be empathic? And I want to explore exactly this question with this video, basically, by presenting the Rogerian view. For those who are more scientifically minded, I want to just briefly state that the Rogerian view of empathy is a practical theory. It's meant to be applied. It has a definite practical application in psychotherapy. It's not a theory that tries to explain all the processes or phenomena that are happening when someone is empathic with another person, but it's more a set of advice or a set of behavioral recommendations that you should do if you want to really understand another person. I think Rogers would probably object to the use of the terms advice or behavioral recommendations, but that is how I understand his view. Later in this video, we will also talk about the question where his conception is kind of imprecise, where you could say more about what is happening, where the theory has gaps basically, but still I think the Rogerian view is a very valuable starting point and it gets a lot of things right. Later in this video, we will also talk about the question where his conception is kind of imprecise, where you could say more about what is happening, where the theory has gaps basically, but still I think the Rogerian view is a very valuable starting point and it gets a lot of things right. Of course, everyone has an idea about what it means to be empathic, but I think there are some aspects in the Rogerian conception that are true and that are not common knowledge. And that is why I think that this video is also interesting for people who are not psychologists. I also want to talk about the possible benefits or the functions that empathy might serve in psychotherapy. And then I want to present some research evidence that links empathy to the outcome in psychotherapy. So empathy might even be a factor that decides whether a psychotherapy is successful or not. Of course, this does not mean that it's the only factor. As you can probably imagine, empathy is not only important in psychotherapy, but also in many different areas of life as well, and also in many different professions. And I listed some areas where empathy is important here, for example, in other health-related jobs or professions. As a teacher, it's very important to understand the frame of mind of your students, what their questions are, what they are thinking. You have to directly work with this. That is my opinion, at least. That is my philosophy of teaching. You can't just do your thing. You need to address what your students are thinking. And for that, you need empathy. But empathy is also important in personal relationships, especially if things are not going smoothly, if there are conflicts. Assuming that the person you have a conflict with is important to you and that you want to continue the relationship, it might be important to find a compromise, and empathy facilitates this process because if you are ready to understand the other person's viewpoint and if you are ready to understand what the other person wants, then this is the first step to solving the problem and finding a compromise that both persons can agree with. So empathy might be essential in resolving conflicts. And then, if you see that someone else is not doing well, a friend of yours, for example, then you need empathy as well, of course. So I think that the question, what does it mean to be empathic, is not just interesting for psychotherapists, but basically for anyone. Even though empathy seems to be a universal thing that concerns everyone, Rogers often states that it's actually quite rare that you rarely see empathic understanding in full-fledged form, and I want to present you a video where he says this.
I think it's one of the most delicate and potent tools that we have, and I'm impressed at how rarely we see it in real-life situations in any full-fledged form.
Why does he say this? Here I have a quote by him that explains this a bit more in detail. He says, "I suspect that each of us has discovered that this kind of understanding is extremely rare. We neither receive it nor offer it with any great frequency. Instead, we offer another type of understanding, which is very different. I understand what is wrong with you, or I understand what makes you act this way. These types of understanding are not really empathic, according to Carl Rogers, because they're more like a diagnosis, and if you understand a person in this way, then you are very far from the person's experience or perception of things. And that is what empathy is all about. It's about trying to understand the other's perception. Or another type of understanding would be, I too have experienced your trouble and I reacted very differently. These are types of understanding which we usually offer and receive, an evaluative understanding from the outside. But when someone understands how it feels and seems to be me, without wanting to analyze me or judge me, then I can blossom and grow in that climate. So these types of understanding are evaluations, basically, and that is not what empathy is all about. Empathy is not about analyzing the other person or finding out what the causes of his or her behavior are or what is wrong with this person, or saying that one has experienced the same thing and that one has reacted differently. This is not empathy at all. Empathy means really understanding the other from the inside, basically, trying to get an idea of the other person's subjective world or the other person's perceptions. Trying to get a sense of what it feels like to be the other person. Anyway, let us get back to the idea that empathy is somehow something rare. Why is that? Because for Carl Rogers, empathy is a very complex process and there are several aspects to it. For example, You try to assume the internal frame of reference of the other person. That's what I already said, basically. You try to see things from the perspective of the other person, and you do not try to make statements about the other person from your perspective. That is not empathic. So if the therapist makes statements about the client from his or her perspective, then he or she assumes the external frame of reference. The internal frame of reference is the perspective of the client, and the external frame of reference is the perspective of the therapist. And then you try to listen for meanings that are just below the surface. Sometimes it's not exactly clear what the client wants to say, what the personal meaning of the statement is, and as a therapist you have to listen for the personal meaning. What is it that this person wants to express? Sometimes this meaning is just a little bit concealed, and later I will show examples of this, where Carl Rogers does exactly this, trying to find out the personal meaning of a statement. And then there's another aspect that we rarely do in our daily lives when we try to be empathic. We usually do not communicate our understanding. This is very important in therapy, because by doing this, you show the client that you understand him or her. And that's something that we should maybe think about in our daily lives when we try to be empathic. In how far do we show that we understand the other person? Can the other person even be sure that we understand this person? Well, if you want the other person to be sure that you understand the person, then you should communicate what you have understood. And by doing so, you give the other person a chance to correct your understanding. The thing is, communication is very difficult, and there are many opportunities to misunderstand something. And by communicating your understanding, you give the other the chance to possibly correct something that you have understood wrong. And when you try to be empathic, you should let yourself be guided by the other's answers. You should not think that you already know what the other person is feeling or thinking. You should have an open mind. You should be ready to correct your understanding. Otherwise, your understanding can be wrong very easily. Another feature of empathy is that you do not evaluate the other person. And empathy also means that you do not identify directly with the other person. You are still a separate person with an own perspective. These are also important features. So here is the whole list of the aspects of empathy in the Rogerian view. What do you think about these points? Do you agree or disagree? Write a comment if you want. Anyway, I want to continue. I want to go through all these points one by one in detail, but before doing so, I want to give you a short clip of Carl Rogers where he explains empathic understanding.
And that last brings me to the third element in the kind of relationship I want to create. Can I understand this person sensitively, accurately? Can I understand him with empathy, which means getting inside his world and seeing his world from his own point of view? Can I really sense the flavor of his feelings and the attitudes that he's talking about? Here's a bright, attractive, married woman who tells me that she finds life so hopeless that she often considers suicide. Can I really understand how, with all her good qualities, nevertheless, life can seem that way to her? That's what I mean by really understanding from within. Can I see how remote and alone and hopeless she feels, in spite of what all the rest of us might think of as very positive elements in her life?
All right, the important phrases were getting inside his world and seeing his world from his own point of view, sense the flavor of his feelings and the attitudes that he's talking about. Then he gave the example of a bright, attractive woman who finds life hopeless, even though she objectively seems to have very good qualities. Empathy is not about the objective part of things, but it's about trying to understand the subjective viewpoint. Yeah, It's about trying to get the personal meaning. Yeah, subjective perceptions. Anyway, I want to start with the first point, and there's a nice little exercise that he presents in his book that he published in 1951, Client-Centered Therapy, that makes it clear what it means to assume the internal frame of reference of the other person. The exercise, here are the instructions. First, read the following client's monologue. I will present a client's monologue, and you can pause the video while I present this, but I'm also going to read it aloud. You can also read the monologue in the description. I will post it in the description of this video. Imagine while reading this monologue that you are the therapist. And then imagine what kind of thoughts would run through your head if you were the therapist. You can write them down if you want. You should just be aware of what kind of thoughts you are thinking while reading this monologue. So are the instructions clear? Let's go ahead and read the client's monologue. I don't feel very normal, but I want to feel that way. I thought I'd have something to talk about, then it all goes around in circles. I was trying to think what I was going to say. Then coming here, it doesn't work out. I tell you, it seemed that it would be much easier before I came. I tell you, I just can't make a decision. I don't know what I want. I've tried to reason this thing out logically, tried to figure out which things are important to me. I thought that there are maybe two things a man might do. He might get married and raise a family. But if he was just a bachelor, just making a living, that isn't very good. I find myself in my thoughts getting back to the days when I was a kid and I cry very easily. The dam would break through. I've been in the army 4.5 years. I had no problems then, no hopes, no wishes. My only thought was to get out when peace would come. My problems now that I'm out are as ever. I tell you, they go back to a long time before I was in the army. I love children. When I was in the Philippines, I tell you, when I was young, I swore I'd never forget my unhappy childhood. So when I saw these children in the Philippines, I treated them very nicely. I used to give them ice cream cones and movies. It was just a period I'd reverted back, and that awakened some emotions in me I thought that I had long buried. Then he pauses and he is very near tears at the end of this monologue. So, what were your thoughts while reading this? Well, here are some thoughts that might be representative for an external frame of reference. For example, I wonder if I should help him get started talking. Or, is this inability to get underway a type of dependence? This is a very analytical, diagnostic thought. Why this indecisiveness? What could be its cause? What is meant by this focus on marriage and family? He seems to be a bachelor, I hadn't known that. The crying, the dam, sound as though there must be a great deal of repression. He's a veteran. Could he have been a psychiatric case? I feel sorry for anybody who spent 4.5 years in the service. Sometime he will probably need to dig into those early unhappy experiences. What is this interest in children? Identification? And here's how Carl Rogers comments these thoughts. He says, these are sympathetic questions or comments. They are not wrong per se, but it's more understanding about the client than understanding with. The locus of perceiving is outside the client. These are thoughts from the external frame of reference, from the therapist's perspective. And here are thoughts that might represent an internal frame of reference if you are successful in assuming an internal frame of reference. You're wanting to struggle towards normality, aren't you? It's really hard for you to get started. Decision making just seems impossible to you. You want marriage, but it doesn't seem to you to be much of a possibility. You feel yourself brimming over with childish feelings. To you, the army represented stagnation. Being very nice to children has somehow had meaning for you, but it was, and it is, a disturbing experience for you. And here are the comments on these thoughts. He says that here you are probably more successful in assuming the internal frame of reference, because you are not enumerating facts about the client, but these are statements about the client's perceptions. And there's a fine difference. But if you state these thoughts in the final declarative form, then again you assume the external frame of reference. Because empathic statements are always tentative. They are hypotheses. They are not definite and declarative statements. You offer them as a hypothesis and the other has the chance to correct you. And that's important. Roger says that the best vantage point for understanding behavior is from the internal frame of reference of the individual himself. The only way to understand his behavior meaningfully is to understand it as he perceives it himself. When that is done, the various meaningless, strange behaviors are seen to be part of a meaningful and goal-directed activity. So without this empathic understanding, it is possible that you do not understand a certain behavior at all, but once you understand the subjective perceptions of the other person, this behavior makes total sense. Of course, this isn't always the case, but most of the times it is much easier to understand a behavior if you understand the subjective perceptions that go along with it. So you might say, well, relying on the client's subjective perceptions is nice, but there will be things that are totally unconscious that the client is not aware of. So, and the second problem is that communication is always faulty and imperfect, so the client might not even be able to express exactly what he or she wants to say. And then again, my understanding might be wrong. And let's talk about the first one. Well, you might say, as a therapist, it's possible that I see way more than my client does. Should I ignore this? What if I see things that are totally unconscious? Well, Carl Rogers' attitude is that verbalizing things that are just below the surface, explicating the meaning basically, is perfectly fine. But then again, he's no fan of interpretation as it is done in psychodynamic therapies. And there were several incidents or experiences that he made that contributed to this attitude that he doesn't like interpretation. And for example, he says, I have not found it satisfying or helpful to intervene in the client's experience with diagnostic or interpretative explanations, nor with suggestions or guidance. That is his attitude, and now I want to give you two examples of such incidents that led him to this conclusion. But he says that there were many more incidents. First, he says, I was astonished that sometimes after a particularly good interview, where I had interpreted to a boy all the causes of his misbehavior, he refused to see me the next day. This is, of course, a bad thing, a disruption of the therapeutic relationship, basically. I began to learn experientially. And then there's a second incident that is very well known. It's a very famous incident that happened before 1940, so very early in Roger's career. At the time, he had experience with children. He was a child therapist. And in this incident, Rogers had to give advice to a mother who had problems with her delinquent son. And, well, I will paint you the scene. Here's Rogers on the right and here's the woman on the left. And the problem was that the son was delinquent, that he was a bit of a hellion. That's how he describes it. And he didn't really do therapy with this woman or the son. He gave advice. And his idea was that the problem is her rejection of her son. And he tried to make her see this. He was very determined to make her see this because he thought that this would help. Once she could see this pattern that she rejects her son, she would treat her son differently and that would change the son's behavior. So that is what he did. He tried to show her all the evidence for this pattern. And yeah, he tried very hard and somehow it didn't really help. Somehow both of them came to the conclusion that they are getting nowhere. And Rogers told her, well, we have tried and we have failed. I think we might as well give up our contacts. And she agreed. And just as she was leaving, she stopped at the door, that is why the door is important, and turned around and she said, wait, do you ever take adults for counseling here? And Rogers answered, yes, we do. And then she came back to the chair and said, well, then I would like some help. And then she started to talk about her problems in her marriage, about her sense of failure, that she feels that she has failed, etc., that she feels confused. And Rogers was completely blown away. He writes that what she was saying was completely different from the sterile case history she had given before. And this was the start of a successful therapy. So that's the experience. He tried very hard to interpret her behavior to her. It didn't work at all. But once he started listening to her, somehow something was set in motion. That is one example why he says this.
Very early in my work as therapist, I discovered that simply listening to my client very attentively was an important way of being helpful. So when I was in doubt as to what I should do in some active way, I simply listened. And it seemed surprising to me that such a passive kind of interaction could be so useful.
He also wrote that it is the client who knows what hurts, what directions to go, what problems are crucial, what experiences have been deeply buried. It began to occur to me that unless I had a need to demonstrate my own cleverness and learning, I would do better to rely upon the client for the direction of movement in the process. We are still talking about interpretations, and he wrote about empathy. It means sensing meanings of which he or she is scarcely aware, but not trying to uncover totally unconscious feelings, since this would be too threatening. So there's this conviction that the client knows what is important and what he needs, and that as a therapist you just have to listen to the client. It's not your job to interpret the client's behavior to the client. But it's perfectly fine to listen for meanings that are just a little bit concealed. And you might say, isn't this also a form of interpretation? And I think it depends on how you use the word interpretation. I think there are two meanings of the word, basically. And those meanings are proposed by Sachse. Rainer Sachse is a German psychologist who started out as a client-centered therapist and a behavioral therapist. And he later developed his own form of psychotherapy, which he calls clarification-oriented psychotherapy. He also wrote books on client-centered therapy. Anyway, he says that there are two meanings of the word interpretation. First, it means that you try to understand what the client means, and this involves going beyond what was said by the client. So there is a form of interpretation happening here. And then you might mean it in the way that you put what was said into a theoretical context, that you, for example, explain the cause why someone is feeling a certain way. For example, if you explain to someone that he feels a certain thing because he made certain experiences in his or her childhood, then what you're doing is also interpretation. And that's the second form that is listed here. And I guess Rogers is completely fine with the first form of interpretation, but not really with the second one, I think. Now, let's have a look. What does this mean? Listening for meanings that are just below the surface. What does a client-centered therapist do here? I want to give you a few examples of Carl Rogers himself to give you an idea what listening for meanings that are just below the surface means. But first, I want to show you a clip where Rogers talks about this.
And a little later, a social worker whom I hired who had had a background of Rankian training was really most helpful to me. She helped me to learn that the most effective response, the most effective listening, was where you listened for the feelings and emotions that were behind the words, that were just a little bit concealed, and where you could discern a pattern of feeling behind what was being said. And I think she's the one who first suggested that the best response was to reflect these feelings to the client. And reflect is a word that later made me cringe, but at the time it really was very helpful to me in my work as a therapist, and I was very grateful to her. I felt I learned a great deal from her, and she learned very little from me.
Okay, let's start with the first example.
Or a boy at the state hospital who gives me a confused story about property assessments of all things and tries to tell me how property is assessed, and once it's assessed, it stays that way for a long, long time, even though the property keeps changing. And as I listen and listen to him talk about that, I begin to sense the meaning. That he's trying to tell me that though things remain the same on the surface, yet things are changing underneath. And I'd like to really sense the way in which that seems to him. And through his garbled talk, to get the personal meaning that he's trying to communicate.
So it seems that there was a deeper meaning to the superficial story of property assessment. Moving on to the second example, once he had an interview with an adolescent boy, and the boy said, "I have no goals whatsoever in life." And Kyle Rogers answered, "There isn't anything you want to do?" And the boy said, "Nothing. Well, yeah, I want to keep on living." And Kyle Rogers comments this phrase by writing, "I resonated very deeply with this phrase, I want to keep on living. He might simply be telling me that, like everyone else, he wanted to live. On the other hand, he might be telling me, and this seemed to be a definite possibility, that at some point the question of whether or not to live had been a real issue with him." So what the client means isn't clear. There is some meaning that might be concealed here. And Rogers writes, "I didn't know for certain what the meaning was. I simply wanted to be open to any meanings that this statement might have. My being willing and able to listen to him at all levels is perhaps one of the things that made it possible for him to tell me before the end of the interview that not long before he had been on the point of blowing his brains out." And the third example from Roger's private life. Once he received a long distance call from a friend, and at the end of the telephone call, Rogers thought to himself, "There seemed to be a note of distress, discouragement, even despair, which had nothing to do with the matter at hand." And Rogers decided to write a letter to this friend, and he wrote, "I may be all wrong in what I'm going to say, and if so, you can toss this in the wastebasket, but I realized after I hung up the phone that you sounded as though you were in real distress and pain. Perhaps in real despair." And Rogers wasn't sure at all about this, about sending this letter. He did it anyway, and he thought to himself, "Maybe I am ridiculously mistaken." But he received a reply that said something along the lines of, "I am so grateful that somebody heard me." So Kyle Rogers' intuition was correct here. There was somehow a deeper meaning to what the friend was trying to communicate. And Kyle Rogers heard that, basically. Moving on to a fourth and last example from the video Three Approaches to Psychotherapy 2.
It's like, I don't really trust that I can trust you to know that I can tell you this and that you may feel a little something about it. But what then, you know? I mean, you know, it's a nice story. So, big deal.
What I hear in that is that you feel that I don't really care. Just a story, just
That's right.
Something. What if I do
care? You know?
But what if I do care?
I want to make a joke and say, I'll go on.
So that is a very important thing for empathic understanding. Trying to understand the personal meaning and trying to listen for meanings that are just below the surface. Anyway, let's move on to the next point. And the next point is that you need to communicate your understanding to prove that you have understood the other person, basically.
I sense how frightening his world is for him, how tightly he tries to hold it in place. I would like to sense his feelings, and I would like him to know that I understand his feelings. I would like him to know that I stand with him in his tight, constricted little world, and that I can look upon it unafraid.
The important sentence in this clip for me was, I'd like him to know that I understand his feelings. And to do that, you need to communicate your understanding, and that is something that client-centered therapists very often do. They paraphrase or try to summarize what the other person has said in order to communicate what they have understood. Take a look.
I have become very much aware since my husband was killed last December. My own feelings of aloneness. And I don't think it's directly related to his death, because we had been separated for about 4 years before he was killed. And I became aware that after he died, especially, that he was really very important in my life. I was kind of using him as a shield against going out and having other relationships. And now he's gone and I can't use that anymore. And I feel very, very frightened of new male relationships.
So that in some way his death really made you more aware of the fear you have of new relationships, especially with men.
Right, definitely.
You know, I'm smiling, but there's a lot of, and I'm sure you know that, there's a lot of anger there, you know, but it's not my nature to be angry. It's not my nature to be angry, but I feel angry.
So I hear you explaining that that's not my nature to be angry. It's just that I am angry right now.
For sure. For sure.
I want to approve of me always, but my actions won't let me. I want to approve of me. I think...
I realize you... All right, but let me... Because I'd like to understand that. You sound as though your actions are kind of outside of you. You want to approve of you, but what you do somehow won't let you approve of yourself.
Right.
It seems to me that this, I've been thinking about this lately, and it seems to me that the everything seems to be filtered through this. My accomplishments are filtered through this idea that I'm still not competent in what I'm doing.
I just feel I'm not up to it. I don't know enough. I might be nervous. I might fail. I'm really not up to it.
Yeah, it's like even when I do succeed, I tell myself that.
Rainer Sachse, the German psychologist I talked about earlier, even uses the word proof. You should prove to your clients that you understand them. Sometimes this can mean that you find even more precise and accurate words for what the client wants to express. And I have an example of that here.
You know, just like somebody took a big goddamn tree and just rammed it up. Oh, so, you know, hard to describe, you know. You know?
Took a good big stick and rammed it up your ass, is that what you're saying?
I didn't say that.
Is that what you meant?
That's what I meant.
Okay. That's what I wanted to know, whether I was catching your meaning correctly.
Yeah, for sure. You know, and you know that probably would be painful.
Okay, that wasn't meant that seriously, but it happens. Sometimes the therapist can help the client in expressing more clearly what the client wants to express by finding just some kind of term that might be more accurate. Let's move on to the next point.
It includes communicating your sensings of his world as you look with fresh and unfrightened eyes at elements of which he is fearful. It means frequently checking with him as to the accuracy of your sensings and being guided by his responses. You are a confident companion to him in his world.
So that is the next aspect, that you are guided by the other person's answers. You should not approach the situation with the attitude that you already know what the other feels and thinks, etc. But you should be open to letting yourself be corrected by the other person.
Let me see if I understand that you feel as though what the culture and people and so on have done to you has really caused you more suffering than the leukemia. Is that what you're saying?
I think so. Mm-hmm. I think so.
I sort of get the feeling you like mm-hmm. this aspect of you that is able to be with me in a way that is more open, more vulnerable, perhaps.
Well, I like it, and I also scold myself for being dependent. So mm-hmm. there's something missing in the middle to mm-hmm. connect. Mm-hmm.
So as you could see, he immediately corrected his understanding, saying that there are both sides in her. Unfortunately, I didn't find a clip where Carl Rogers got something completely wrong. This would also be great to see how he corrects himself or how he corrects his understanding. But that is something important. You should be open to correction by your client. Let us move on to the next point, which is that we often do not listen empathically, but that we rather evaluate the other from our own perspective, and that is not empathy. And this is described by Carl Rogers in the following clip.
Now, it's simply incredibly difficult for most of us to simply understand without judging, to see the other person's point of view without making judgments about it. We have absolutely no experience of that kind in our social conversation or in our ordinary life. When you listen to this talk or when you listen to your friends speak, you immediately begin to form judgments about it. You don't listen to try to get the other person's point of view. You try to make judgments of it from your point of view. That's why I find that in training counselors, it's terribly difficult to get them simply to be willing to understand from within and to stop at that point. I think people who do listen and understand and who don't judge are deeply valued in any community where they live. They get to be known as people who help.
The second aspect is that you do not identify with the other person, that you do not experience the same thing, but rather that you experience it as if you were the other person. I don't know if that is totally possible, but he describes this in the following quote. The state of empathy, or being empathic, is to perceive the internal frame of reference of another with accuracy and with the emotional components and meanings which pertain thereto, as if one were the other person, but without ever losing the as if condition. By the way, he later corrected himself, saying it's not a state, but a process. So this should be corrected to the process of empathy. Thus, it means to sense the hurt or the pleasure of another as he senses it, and to perceive the causes thereof as he perceives them, but without ever losing the recognition that it is as if I were hurt or pleased and so forth. If this as if quality is lost, then the state is one of identification. And then there's a paper that I read, which contains a pretty convincing argument why therapist and client do not experience the same emotion. This paper is written by Tengland, and he writes that the feelings of the client and the therapist have a different aboutness. They are about different things. Example, let us say that the client is sad about the loss of someone. The therapist will be sad about a different thing. He will probably be sad about the fact that the client is sad. So he will be sad about a certain experiential state of the client. And that is different. And Tengland writes the following sentence. He writes, empathy, if it is an emotion, has to include beliefs and wishes about the person empathized with. Something that by definition makes it another emotion than the one empathized with. So it is definitely a different emotional state because the emotion is about something else. Tengland develops this argument in much more detail, so I would recommend you the paper. You can see the full title of the paper at the end in the reference list. Anyway, now I have a quote by Carl Rogers who talks about the fact that empathy kind of means leaving behind your own values and entering the world of another, but at the same time you don't get lost in the world of the other. Take a look.
Now, to be with another in this way means that for the time being you lay aside the views and values that you hold for yourself in order to enter his world without prejudice. In some sense, it means that you lay aside yourself, and this can only be done by a person who is secure enough in himself that he knows he will not get lost in what may turn out to be the strange or bizarre world of the other, and can comfortably return to his own world when he wishes.
All right, that was everything that I wanted to say about the Rogerian conception of empathy. Now let's have a look at what is missing. What are the limitations of this view? In my opinion, there are several gaps in this conception, but one should keep in mind that it is a practical theory that has been created for practical purposes, and it's not so much a theory about the phenomenon of empathy per se. I have formulated some questions that show at which points you could be more precise. For example, more can be said about the processes that are happening within the therapist and the client. Carl Rogers wasn't too precise about that. And then you could say more about what information the therapist can and should listen for. Carl Rogers was rather unspecific. I mean, basically he said that you should listen for personal meanings and the feelings that are behind what is said. But in different schools of therapy, you would answer this question differently. For example, as a cognitive behavioral therapist, you would try to listen for dysfunctional thinking patterns, for example. So depending on the system of therapy, you would answer this question, what is it that the therapist focuses on when listening to the client? You would answer this question differently. And then you could say much more about the client's behavior, because there are situations where the client's behavior kind of prevents the therapist from understanding the client. Sometimes a client doesn't want to be understood, and you could analyze these situations in much more detail. And then you could say more about the therapist's verbal behavior. A therapist can also do a lot of things wrong that prevent him from really understanding the client. And you could analyze these situations also in more detail. Let's talk about the first question first. What are the processes happening within the therapist or the empathic person? Well, first, there's the standard differentiation between cognitive and affective empathy. Cognitive empathy means that you understand the other's situation or frame of mind on a cognitive level, and there isn't necessarily a feeling of concern or an affective component involved in cognitive empathy. Even psychopaths have cognitive empathy. And then there's affective empathy, which means that there's a feeling involved, that you can kind of feel what the other person feels, or that somehow you feel a similar thing, or that there's at least some empathic concern on your part that is a bodily felt sensation. Elliot, Bohart, Watson and Murphy published a meta-analysis, and in this meta-analysis they also analyze empathy a bit and write that in neuroscience three processes have been identified. First, there is an automatic emotional simulation process, and that is basically affective empathy, I think. This means that the empathic person somehow simulates the emotion that the other feels. And the basis for this are probably mirror neurons. This is an automatic process. And then there's a more deliberate process, which is a perspective-taking process. And I think that this is cognitive empathy. And then there's a third process, which is an emotion regulation process. So as the empathic person, you feel a certain emotion and you regulate this emotion in yourself. And this might help to mobilize compassion and helping behavior. So the question one could ask is, in how far is it important for a therapist to have affective empathy? And that means that the therapist really feels something on an emotional level. I don't want to answer the question whether he feels the same as the client, but maybe this is important that the therapist does feel an empathic concern, or that the therapist does feel something. And maybe the third process, the emotion regulation process, is really important so that the therapist can help in an effective way. Maybe the skill of regulating your emotions while being empathic is really decisive to be able to respond in a helpful way. You could analyze much more in detail what it actually is that the therapist feels, and I would again refer you to the book chapter written by Tengland that presents a convincing argument that the therapist definitely does not feel the same as the client. Even if the therapist is a complete master at empathy, the emotional state still seems to be different, as it is described in this book chapter. But when you analyze the processes that are happening within the therapist, then you do not only talk about the emotional processes, there's of course a lot that has to do with information processing. And you could say much more about that than Rogers ever did. And the German psychologist I mentioned earlier, called Rainer Sachse, says a lot more about that. Rainer Sachse writes that the idea that you directly put yourself in your client's shoes should be just seen as a metaphor. This is not really what is happening, because understanding always happens on the basis of what you already know. And this is also the case in therapy. The client provides verbal, paraverbal, and nonverbal data that needs to be interpreted, and this can only happen on the basis of what the therapist already knows. So this idea that you completely leave behind everything that you know, and that you completely enter the other's frame of reference, isn't exactly what is happening. That's his criticism, basically. But still, I think there's some merit to this metaphor, because, well, there's a fine difference, as we saw earlier, if you assume the client's frame of reference versus if you state things from your own frame of reference. Let's compare, for example, these two comments. If you say, you have difficulties with making a decision, then this is a comment from the external frame of reference. It's a statement from your perspective, what you see. And then you could also say, making a decision seems to be really difficult right now, doesn't it? And this would be more a statement from the internal frame of reference of the client. And there could be a difference in how the clients react to that. My prediction is that the second comment will stimulate and deepen the client's narrative flow more than the first comment. And this might be a criterion for successful empathy. If you are successful at being empathic, then your comments stimulate and deepen the client's narrative flow. And I believe that comments from the internal frame of reference are more likely to do that. And that is why I think that there is some merit to this idea that you assume the other's internal frame of reference, even if it is just a metaphor. Let's talk about the third point, that understanding can only happen on the basis of what you already know. Rogers says that you, in a sense, you lay aside yourself, and Rainer Sachse basically says that this is not possible. And that is why you should, as a therapist, be very aware of how you perceive things and interpret them, because otherwise it's very much possible to introduce a bias. And this is not a bad thing per se, I mean, therapists are only humans, but sometimes a bias like this can really prevent you from understanding the other person. And that is why you should be aware of how you perceive things. So this was the first gap in the Rogerian conception, basically. Rogers wasn't too clear about the processes that are happening within the therapist, whether they are emotional processes or processes that have to do with information processing. Let's proceed to the next question. And that is the question, what does the therapist listen for? What is the important information for the therapist? What information do therapists focus on? And Rogers did say something about that. To him, it was important to listen for the personal meaning that a statement might have and to listen for emotional components. Elliot, Bohart, Watson and Murphy wrote that person-centered therapy has focused on the cognitive or perspective-taking aspect of empathy. They write that by some accounts, 70% or more of Carl Rogers' responses were to felt meaning rather than to feeling, despite the fact that his mode of responding is typically called reflection of feeling. And there's an implicit criticism here that you could be more attuned to the client's emotions and work more with the client's emotions as they unfold from moment to moment. And this is of course done in emotion-focused therapy. Emotion-focused therapy is much more precise about this, about how you address the client's emotions. And it basically was to be expected that this criticism would come from Elliot, Bohart, Watson and Murphy, because they are all emotion-focused therapists. But of course they are right, I guess, that Rogers' responses were more to the felt meaning and that you could work a lot more with emotions. And that is why emotion-focused therapy has been developed, of course. It seems to be a logical progression from client-centered therapy. It seems like a logical next step to explain this more in detail, how you work with the emotional components. Rainer Sachse also has something to say about what you listen for. Rainer Sachse writes that the client's perspective is always a construction that needs to be clarified. And this means that the client's perspective is never an objective image of reality, but that the client constructs his perspective, and there are several determinants that decide what the result of such a construction is. And those determinants are, for example, schemas, motives, norms and values. And that is what you should listen for. Which determinants play a role that led to the client's perspective of things? Cognitive behavioral therapists would probably say that you might focus on dysfunctional convictions. So there are different ways of answering this question. What should you listen for? You could focus on the client's emotions. You could focus on schemas, motives, norms and values, or dysfunctional convictions. And I guess it really depends on the school of therapy that you have been trained in, what you listen for. So there are different ways of answering this question. Let's proceed to the next point. You could say much more about the client's verbal behavior. Because as I said earlier, this behavior, this verbal behavior, is determined by schemas, motives, etc. The therapist's job is to reconstruct what the client means. And the thing is that a client usually means much more than what he says, because there are also unconscious aspects to what a client means. Well, the thing is also that clients do not always want to be understood. Sometimes they do not want the therapist to reconstruct what they mean, and there are several reasons for that. Of course, there are social motives at play here. That is one possibility why a client might not want the therapist to understand him, because you basically want the therapist to have a positive view of yourself. And especially if you are a narcissist, you want the therapist to admire you. And there might be all sorts of social motives that prevent you as a client from wanting to be understood by the therapist. And those social motives especially play a role in the context of personality disorders. People with personality disorders often play interactional games. They want something from the therapist. They want the therapist to fulfill their needs, and they do that by displaying manipulative behavior. And that is why they have conflicts with the people around them often. And this is a reason why a client might not want to be understood. And then again, of course, clients sometimes want to hide a certain content because of shame or avoidance, and it's only human. I guess that is a very common occurrence in therapy. So as you can see, There are several obstacles to accurate empathic understanding on the part of the client. And those obstacles could be analyzed in much more detail than Carl Rogers ever did. And then again, there might be aspects of the therapist's behavior that prevent the therapist from really understanding the client. And this becomes pretty clear if you think about the fact that it's actually not really possible to be entirely non-directive. As a therapist, you focus on certain aspects, and sometimes you focus on irrelevant aspects, and sometimes you miss relevant aspects. So, a bad focus of your attention might prevent you from really understanding your client, basically. And you could analyze what the therapist does in much more detail than Rogers ever did. And Rainer Sachse, for example, proposes a distinction between the synthetic mode of processing and the analytic mode of processing. What does this mean? When you are in the synthetic mode of processing, you try to reconstruct everything that the client has meant. You try to reconstruct everything that there is to reconstruct from the client's statements. And when you are in the analytic mode, you do the opposite, basically. You try to find out or think about which information is missing, what is still unclear. And both modes of processing are important for a therapist to get a clear picture. And as you can imagine, there are several mistakes possible. For example, there are so-called traps of plausibility. And that means that a construction of the client or a perception of the client seems to be so plausible to you that you do not really ask the necessary questions to clarify this construction. For example, let's say the therapist thinks, of course it is hurtful if your partner doesn't listen to you in the evening. So he accepts this as a given, basically, maybe because the therapist has experienced the same thing. But if you accept this as a given, you miss the opportunity to clarify what the motives behind this experience are, or what the expectations behind this experience are. To clarify these expectations, it might be necessary to ask the question, what is so hurtful about that? And if you just accept this as a given, if this seems completely plausible to you, this kind of experience, then you fail to ask this question. And this might even lead to a standstill in therapy. So here you do not have a complete picture of the client's experience because you fail to ask certain deeper questions. And this can prevent you from really understanding the client. So as you can see, you can also do something wrong as a therapist. Rainer Sachse even writes that completely understanding the client might lead to a standstill. It's not even desirable, because it's sometimes important to not understand, to question things. Because if you understand everything, then no new information will be introduced into the client's system, basically. And if you question things, then maybe the client will explore himself or herself more. And Rice and Greenberg call this empathic non-understanding. So maybe it's not even desirable to understand everything. So as you can see, there are several points in the Rogerian conception where you could analyze things more in detail. For example, you could say more about the processes that are happening within the empathic person or the client's and the therapist's behavior that might prevent the therapist from understanding something. Or you could be more precise about what information you listen for, because in today's therapies, schemas, motives, or dysfunctional cognitions play a role. And of course, these terms didn't really play a role in client-centered therapy, as it is a non-directive approach. Still, I want to be clear about the fact that I think that the Rogerian conception gets a lot of things right, and that it's a great starting point for thinking about empathy. And next, I want to talk about the functions that empathic understanding might serve in the context of psychotherapy. Empathic understanding has a function for the client, for the therapist, and also for the therapeutic relationship. But first, I want to show you a clip of Carl Rogers where he talks about such functions.
People ask, why does this help? Why does if you just understand a person, doesn't that confirm him in what he's doing? Doesn't it make him settled in his problems? No, that's not so. If I understand a mother who's rejecting her child, or an errant husband or someone of that sort, and can understand him accurately and accept him completely, then that creates in him the most positive basis for change that I know. That's the kind of climate which permits a person to change and makes it likely that he will change. Whereas without any understanding and without any acceptance, individuals are often frozen into the very behavior patterns which they wish they could leave behind.
So as you could see, for Carl Rogers, empathic understanding is absolutely essential for change. And if that is so, then empathic understanding has an important function for the client. Of course, this is pretty controversial whether empathy is a cause for therapeutic success, whether it is causally linked to therapeutic success. And I will later show you the results of a meta-analysis that seem to be consistent with this view. But it's still not entirely clear, and it's also, I think, pretty clear that it's not the only causal factor that leads to a therapy's success. This might be self-evident to you, but I think that this is important to say, because for client-centered therapists, empathy is the main causal agent of success. And I think there are, of course, many different factors. Let's have a look at the different functions that I identified. First, I want to talk about the function that it has for the client. And for Carl Rogers, empathy sets the process of therapy in motion, basically. And that is the process of self-exploration. The person starts to think about his feelings, or starts to perceive his or her feelings, starts to verbalize important attitudes, etc. And Rogers refers to the concept of experiencing, which has been developed by Gendlin. And this concept is described in this passage. At all times, there is going on in the human organism a flow of experiencings to which the individual can turn again and again as a referent in order to discover the meaning of those experiences. An empathic therapist points sensitively to the felt meaning which the client is experiencing in this particular moment. In order to help him or her to focus on that meaning and carry it further to its full and uninhibited experiencing. And I want to give you an example so that it becomes more clear what is meant by that. Here there's an example where a man in an encounter group makes vague negative statements about his father. The facilitator says, by the way, facilitator is the term that you would use for the therapist in an encounter group, because an encounter group is not therapy, but it's basically therapy for healthy people or people who do not have a clinical disorder. So the facilitator says, "It sounds as though you might be angry at your father." And the man says, "No, I don't think so." And then the facilitator proposes, maybe you are dissatisfied with him? And the man says, well, yes, perhaps, but he says it rather doubtfully. And then the facilitator says, maybe you're disappointed in him. And the man says, that's it, I am disappointed, that he is not a strong person. And Carl Rogers asks the question, against what is the man checking the terms angry, dissatisfied, and disappointed for correctness? And his answer is, he checks those terms against the psychophysiological flow within himself. And this psychophysiological flow is the inner experiencing that you explore once you receive empathy. That's his idea. And when the client does this, it's possible that he or she discovers previously unknown elements within himself or herself. For example, a client might realize, I never realized that I am afraid of succeeding. And this discovery of unknown elements in the experiencing might lead to a change of the client's self-concept. And this leads to more consistent behavior, basically. That's the theory of change in the client-centered tradition. So that is the first function, which is the function that empathic understanding has for the client. it sets an important process in motion. The second function is also a function for the client. It's more the emotional consequence of empathy. Carl Rogers writes that empathic understanding has the important function of dissolving alienation. And that means that the client feels like a connected part of the human race again. It's more an emotional consequence, and it is described in this quote. Though it may not be articulated clearly, the experience goes something like this. I have been talking about hidden things, partly veiled even from myself, feelings that are strange, possibly abnormal feelings. Feelings I have never communicated to another, nor even clearly to myself. And yet, another person has understood my feelings even more clearly than I do. If someone else knows what I am talking about, what I mean, then to this degree I am not so strange, or alien, or set apart. I make sense to another human being, so I am in touch with, even in relationship with, others. I am no longer an isolate. That is what is meant by dissolving alienation. I mean, if that is the function that empathic understanding has, then it seems to be really, really important. A big problem is if the psychotherapist or doctor does not understand the client. In my opinion, this is quite a catastrophe, because after all, psychotherapists and doctors are the people who are supposed to understand, who are the professionals. And Carl Rogers writes, it is as if the individual concludes, if no one understands me, if no one can grasp what these experiences are like, then I am indeed in a bad way, more abnormal than I thought. And if you get this impression, this will feel really bad. Then there's another description by a patient who says, it's the most terrifying feeling to realize that the doctor can't see the real you. That he can't understand what you feel, and that he's just going to go ahead with his own ideas. I would start to feel that I was invisible or maybe not there at all. Carl Rogers also has some personal comments about this. He writes, when I take the gamble, the risk of trying to share something that is very personal with another individual, and it is not received and not understood, this is a very deflating and a very lonely experience. I have come to believe that such an experience makes some individuals psychotic. And that is a very interesting hypothesis, I think, if psychosis is made worse if you have the experience that you are never understood by anyone. Carl Rogers writes, it causes them to give up hoping that anyone can understand them. Once they have lost that hope, then their own inner world, which becomes more and more bizarre, is the only place where they can live. They can no longer live in any shared human experience. I can sympathize with them because I know that when I try to share some feeling aspect of myself which is private, precious, and tentative, and when this communication is met by evaluation, by reassurance, by distortion of my meaning, my very strong reaction is, oh, what's the use? At such a time, one knows what it is to be alone. So that was the second important function. Let's proceed to the third important function, which is that empathy encourages self-acceptance. And Carl Rogers writes about this, it is impossible accurately to sense the perceptual world of another person unless you value that person and his world, unless you in some sense care. Hence, the message comes through to the recipient that this other individual trusts me, thinks I am worthwhile. And this may lead to this experience. Perhaps I am worth something. Perhaps I could value myself. Perhaps I could care for myself. That is how empathy encourages self-acceptance. Let's talk about the fourth function. If the client is taken seriously, then this contributes to a sense of personhood or identity. And that seems to be positive to me. Carl Rogers writes here, Lange has said that the sense of identity requires the existence of another by whom one is known. Empathy gives that needed confirmation that one does exist as a separate, valued person with an identity. These were the functions that empathy might have for the client. Now let's talk about a function that it might have for the relationship. And this is something that Rainer Sachse writes. He writes that empathic understanding basically creates a trust in the competencies of the therapist. So if the client feels understood and thinks something like, my therapist knows what I'm talking about, then this also might contribute to the impression my therapist might be able to help me. And that is, of course, positive for the therapeutic relationship. Let's proceed with the next function that empathy has for the therapist. It's important for developing a model that is the basis for new planning and interventions. So you need to be empathic to build an accurate model of the client's perceptual world. I know that in client-centered therapy, many have the idea that you should not build a model of your client, that you should be sensitive to the moment, basically, that you should enter each moment with a completely fresh mind, basically. But personally, I think that this is nonsense and that it does make sense to build a model of your client and that you should use this model for new planning and interventions. Well, this is also not something that you would say in client-centered therapy, as it is a non-directive approach. To be honest, I think that this idea of non-directivity should be given up, because I believe that the therapy is more effective if the therapist directs the process a bit. The therapist is the expert for the process, I think, while the client decides what to work on. So, empathy has this important function in any other theoretical orientation. It's maybe not the typical thinking in client-centered therapy, but in any other type of therapy, this is an important reason why you should be empathic. Otherwise, you probably won't have an accurate idea of the client's problems. And that have been all the functions that I have identified. Let's proceed with a note of caution. Sometimes empathy isn't received positively. And here, Elliot, Bohart, Watson, and Murphy write, on the other hand, not all clients respond favorably to explicit empathic expressions. One set of reviewers cited evidence that highly sensitive, suspicious, and oppositional patients perform relatively poorly with therapists who are particularly empathic and involved. Another study found that some clients prefer business-like rather than warm, empathic therapists. Elliot, Bohart, Watson, and Murphy comment this with, of course, when therapists are truly empathic, they attune to their clients' needs and accordingly adjust how and how much they express empathy. So if you're not only able to be empathic, but also understand how much empathy your client needs, then you are the king or the queen of empathy. Anyway, here's another clinical example from a book, which is a dialogue between a depressed elderly woman and her therapist. And here she says, it feels like I'm under a huge, and the therapist finishes the sentence for her, under a suffocating, painful weight. And the woman turns away and stops talking. This is actually quite an empathic performance here, to be able to finish the sentence for the other person. But, book writes, empathy is being able to finish a patient's sentence. Being empathic, though, is not finishing that sentence. Having one's sentence finished is seldom experienced as being understood or comforted, but rather is experienced as intrusive and infantilizing. Book also writes that empathy can be received negatively by people who have trouble with the self-other distinction, because to them, empathy might be even threatening, as if the therapist could read your thoughts. And here's another quote by Elliot, Bohart, Watson, and Murphy. For example, certain fragile clients may find the usual expressions of empathy too intrusive, While hostile clients may find empathy too directive, still other clients may find an empathic focus on feelings too foreign. So, as you can see from this, empathy isn't always received positively. And Book suggested a criterion to decide whether one is on the right track with one's expression of empathy. And Book suggests that you ask yourself, do my responses stimulate and deepen the client's narrative flow or not? And this seems to be a useful criterion. And with that, we have finished this section and proceed to the next one, which is about research. We will have a look at the results of a meta-analysis that links empathy to outcome. And this meta-analysis has been done by Elliot, Bohart, Watson and Murphy. That's the article from which I have quoted several times now. For those of you who don't know what a meta-analysis is, basically, as someone who tries to perform a meta-analysis, you try to summarize many, many studies to estimate how large a certain effect is on average. And here, this meta-analysis is about the link between empathy and therapy outcome. And the databases for this meta-analysis were 82 independent samples with a total number of 6,138 clients. And the general result was that empathy is a moderately strong predictor of therapy outcome with a mean weighted R of 0.28. The 95% confidence interval is between 0.23 and 0.33. I'm not going to explain these statistical measures here, so I hope you forgive me that. This means that clients who have received a lot of empathy tend to have a better therapy outcome, and clients who have received less empathy do not profit as much from therapy. But this leaves open the question whether empathy is a causal agent, whether it is causally linked to outcome. This isn't clear with this. It's just a predictor of outcome. This doesn't mean that empathy is the cause of a good outcome in therapy, but this result is consistent with this idea. It just isn't a definite proof. The authors state that this relationship is equally strong across different theoretical orientations. And I will talk about different measures of empathy a bit, because there are different ways how you could measure empathy. For example, you could ask the client basically, how much empathy have you received basically? And then you could ask an observer who observes the situation, or you could ask the therapist, how empathic were you? And there's also the measure of empathic accuracy. And empathic accuracy is how similar the views are that the therapist has of the client and that the client has of him or herself. You look at how both rate the client on several measures, for example, on personality or on questionnaires that measure symptoms. It is unclear which way of measuring empathy is the best, but you can say which measure is most linked to outcome. And here, the answer is that client-rated empathy is the strongest predictor of the outcome among those measures. And then we have observer-rated empathy on the second spot and therapist-rated empathy on the third spot. And all of those relationships are statistically significant. And that means that these relationships are large enough that they are not a coincidence. Because if you do a study, it is always possible that you find some effect that disappears in the next study you do. And if you have a statistically significant result, then this means that this is probably a reliable result. It's so large that it can't be a coincidence. While these three relationships are statistically significant, they do not differ significantly from each other. And that means that it is unclear that client-rated empathy is really the strongest predictor of outcome, stronger than the other two. That is unclear, because this could be a coincidence. It is possible that in the next study you do, you find that observer-rated empathy is a larger predictor. So you should take this hierarchy with a grain of salt, basically. The last measure is, by the way, unrelated to outcome. So whether client and therapist agree on what the client is like on several measures of personality or symptoms is not linked to outcome in any way, apparently. You could also have a look at how this relationship differs between different client populations. For example, the relationship was strongest for severe chronic incarcerated populations. And then on the second spot, there was the population of mixed or unspecified clients. On the third spot, the relationship was relatively strong for depressed or anxious individuals. On the fourth spot, we have clients with mild, normal, or physical problems. And on the last spot, we have clients with self-damaging activities, such as substance misuse. And we can see here that empathy might be especially important for people who are severely or chronically ill or incarcerated populations. But this conclusion is a bit premature because the authors also write that their statistical tests yielded a significant result. That means that there must be some difference between those groups as far as the strengths of the relationship is concerned. But when you do pairwise comparisons with those populations, then you don't find any significant result, any significant difference between the single populations. That's a bit a striking result, or it's unclear what this means. Or to be more precise, it is unclear whether this order that we have found in this study is reliable. Maybe if we do another meta-analysis, we will find that the different population will be on the number one spot. So the order might be different in different studies. Anyway, there are some typical problems that are connected with research on the effect of empathy in psychotherapy. For example, we sometimes have a restricted range of the predictor and the criterion variables. And that means if you want to find out about the effect of empathy in psychotherapy, you need therapists who are really empathic and you need therapists who are not empathic at all, and everything in between. You need the full range of empathy. This would be perfect in a statistical sense, but of course, most therapists strive to be empathic, and that is why you rather have only empathic therapists. And that is a problem for research. And the same is true for the outcome variables, whether patients profit in the end, or clients profit in the end. And then you have a questionable validity of some outcome measures, and that means that it is not clear whether some outcome measures really measure the success of a therapy or whether they measure something else. And then we have confounding variables. The studies always differ as far as the type of empathy they measure. We had four different possible measures, and they also differ in the outcome variables that they use, and they also differ in the timing of assessment, and that makes comparability across studies always difficult if they differ in many regards. And another problem in this type of research is incomplete reporting of methods and results in some studies. So these are the typical problems that you encounter if you want to do a meta-analysis and summarize many studies. The authors derive a set of clinical recommendations. Among them are that you should not only parrot words, but you should really strive to understand a client's experience. I think this goes without saying. And then they write that the client's report of experienced empathy might be especially interesting because the relationship between empathy and outcome was strongest for this measure. But it's still unclear whether it's reliably stronger for this measure. So if it will stay the same in another meta-analysis. And then they explain that empathy is not something provided by the therapist, but that it is a co-created experience between therapist and client, so that the client also contributes to this. And with this, we are approaching the end of this video. In conclusion, empathic understanding seems to be a very, very important basis for therapy, and it can also be important in daily life, I think. Some features of empathic understanding according to the Rogerian conception are that you try to assume the internal frame of reference, that you listen not just for what the person says, but what the person means, and this is sometimes a little bit concealed, that you try to communicate your understanding so the other person knows that you understand him or her, that you let yourself be guided by the other person's answers instead of approaching the situation with the attitude that you already know what the other person feels, and that empathy also means that you do not evaluate the other person, and that empathy is also not identification. You are still a separate person with separate feelings. And these recommendations are made with a goal in mind that your empathic understanding should be as accurate as possible. And that should be the goal, basically. We have also seen that the Rogerian view kind of lacks precision in some areas, or that it does not deal with some questions at all. But in my personal opinion, it still gets a lot of things right. You can write a comment if you agree or not. I would like to conclude this talk with a fitting quote by Carl Rogers. There are situations in which the empathic way of being has the highest priority. When the other person is hurting, confused, troubled, anxious, alienated, terrified, or when he or she is doubtful of self-worth, uncertain as to identity, then understanding is called for. The gentle and sensitive companionship offered by an empathic person, who must, of course, possess the other two attitudes, provides illumination and healing. In such situations, deep understanding is, I believe, the most precious gift one can give to another. And with that, I have definitely reached the end of my talk. Here is the list of references. Here's the second part of my list of references. I would like to thank you very much for watching, and until next time.